2 years ago, the Hunter was in the grip of drought and a water crisis. Low water levels in our supply dams led to domestic restrictions. The outlook is promising this year, with the Hunter's three water storages having a combined capacity of 82%. But with the onset of summer and increases in water consumption, Hunter Water says there's no room for complacency.
While we ask people to be careful with their water use, we obviously don't expect people to be leaving their gardens dying the like in the present circumstances. We just ask people to be careful, water thoroughly, use drippers, all those things.
Yesterday's warmer than average temperatures led to a sharp increase in water consumption. Over a 24-hour period, the Hunter used 252 megalitres, 25% higher than the average of 200 megalitres. Aside from good storage levels, water quality is also good.
The phosphorus levels have been fairly low in the Williams River, and we've been able to pump water across into Grahamstown, and that's why we've got the storage levels up where they are.
And a seasonal climatic outlook by the National Climate Centre is also good news. It predicts above average rainfall for eastern Australia this spring.
The leaked National Parks report appeared in the media today, claiming a wood resources study carried out by state forests had inflated timber stocks by between 40 and 93%. For North Coast environmentalists, the news came as no surprise.
Totally vindicates my assessment, which is based on state forest's own data and comments by district foresters, that the resource just isn't there.
In fact, a separate report released by Dial and Pew less than a week ago painted an even more perplexing picture. A review based on State Forest's own data for more than 320 compartments found timber resources had been overestimated by an average of 124%.
There's been abundant evidence from State Forest's own documents for months now that the Wood Resources study got it very, very wrong.
State Forest today defended the integrity of its study, saying the data had been put together relatively quickly, and although it wasn't perfect, it was the best available at the time. Green groups say the government's plan to provide loggers with 10-year resource security guarantees will expose it to the prospect of massive compensation claims, because the timber being promised simply doesn't exist. But the ALP is also being threatened by a voter backlash in the bush.
No political party is reflecting the hopes and aspirations of ordinary people out there. This is an opportunity for the Labor Party to say, yes, we do reflect those hopes and aspirations.
Country mayors today lobbied at Parliament House against further quota cuts, saying these would devastate rural communities.
Our town cannot survive and go on beyond this decision. We have no other course of enterprise in the town to take up, and that applies to many of the other timber towns.
Bruce McKenzie, NBN News.
On the Central Coast, nearly 30% of young drivers will be involved in a crash. Figures which have spurred a staff member from Gosford Council into action.
I know a lot of my friends have been in accidents in my age group, and I really feel as though that I can do something, and I'm in a perfect opportunity to do that.
She's teamed up with Wyong Council to organise a series of interactive workshops which encourage 17 to 25-year-olds to be responsible on the road.
I think they realise that some of the things they do are high risk, but a lot of them don't think that it will happen to them. They feel as though it happens to other people.
Last night, a group at Wyoming Community Centre saw for themselves the devastating effects of careless driving. Paralympian David Monk describing how a hit and run accident changed his life.
With a broken back in five places, I broke the ribs on this side, I broke my collarbones, I had other peripheral injuries.
David says it's the informal approach and close contact which makes the program different.
We actually give a personal account of what happens during and after a serious motor accident.
Local police are supporting the project. Organisers hope to make it a monthly event. Sarah Griffiths, NBN News.
Richard Tai travels 45 minutes each day to his job. He works shift work, sometimes finishing at 7 in the morning.
Especially after possibly an overtime shift, your wits are not quite with you where they should be.
Studies by the Road and Traffic Authority show that driver fatigue is a problem not just on extended trips, but short trips as well.
More than half of driver fatigue accidents happen between midnight and 8 in the morning. And statistics show that most of these crashes are work-related.
The Hunter Valley town of Dungog has many commuters who travel 60 or 70 kilometres to work in Newcastle or the coal mines. The local council is running an education program pushing the RTA campaign. People can be killed travelling to and from work.
They need to take a special care in terms of having a good night's sleep, things like that, to make sure that that they don't put themselves at unnecessary risk.
The RTA suggests that apart from getting more sleep, commuters are advised to make arrangements to get picked up after a tiring shift. According to the RTA, employers should also be aware they may be held responsible for fatigue crashes. Peter Ryan, NBN News.
Graham Fowler's involvement in the Shortland Hotel was first revealed by NBN earlier this year. Today, an investigation by the Liquor Enforcement Agency culminated with David Briggs, the licensee at the time, pleading guilty to a breach of the Licensing Act. He admitted that he had failed to declare the financial involvement of disgraced detective Graham Chook Fowler. Fowler left the police service after allegedly being captured on video accepting bribes by the Royal Commission into Police Corruption. As a result of not declaring Fowler's involvement, David Briggs lost the licence to the hotel and was today fined $500. He was described in court as having fallen on hard times and is said to be seriously in debt. He still owes $100,000 to Graham Fowler. Jodie McKay, NBN News.
After months of what organisers have called speculation and suspense, the Bicentenary program will be launched against a backdrop of street performers and stage acts.
I can suggest very strongly that if people like fireworks, outrageous performances and entertainment generally and great music, that they come along tonight.
A huge TV screen has also been set up for the launch. The only discord of the evening is likely to be a protest by those opposed to Bicentenary funding.
I don't think they're coming here. I believe that they're meeting at Town Hall and having their meeting there and then dispersing at 8 o'clock. But we'll just get on with trying to do the best job that we can in presenting something that's been in the planning for a long time.
Only the brave bared the cold and miserable weather at the Cliff in Newcastle this morning for the start of day two of the state titles. The conditions in the water weren't much better. Competitors greeted with a sloppy 1 to 1.5 metre swell, with adventurous surfing needed to impress the judges. Most of the 166 strong field were on show today. Heats in the over 28 men's took up the morning's competition. Greg Moss won the early heat, while Dave Hammond also advanced to tomorrow's second round, finishing first in his heat. A scare for the New South Wales Open and over 28 champion Brett Chalker. With his brilliant record behind him, the Nelson Bay surfer was naturally considered the one to beat in the over 28s, but he didn't win his heat. However, the defending champion will surf tomorrow, edging out Rob Mitchell and Mark Stevens.
Thank you.
Novos were surprise losers to University last weekend, so keen to make the grand final to avenge that defeat, the minor premiers set about destroying Oxford's. A two-goal haul to Amanda Payne was the difference. Novos home 2-1. In the men's match, North sold out West for most of the first half, saving three short corners and numerous other raids. One goal apiece on the siren, and despite extra time, scores were still locked. The sides will return on Wednesday to find a winner. And in soccer, the Newcastle Breakers have been knocked out of the Johnny Walker Cup, beaten last night by Marconi. A capacity crowd in Sydney for the Country Rugby League presentation, the Who's Who of Football honouring the season's outstanding achievers. The Chief won the first major award, the Country Origin Player of the Match. The Newcastle forward was the standout in Country's thrilling victory at Steelers Stadium earlier this year. A last-minute offload found support and victory on the siren.
I just love it every time, and to win it, to win an award, you know, is terrific also. So it gets said a fair bit, but I really do. I like playing for Country.
The major presentation followed.
The MMI Country Player of the Year for 1996 is Brett Gallard of Orange CYMS Club.
Orange Sims and Western Division's fullback Brett Gallard was overwhelmed. The award another step towards the dream of first grade in the Optus Cup.
It's a dream, but hopefully it'll be reality next year. So there's a couple of feelers, so I don't know.
Gallard's efforts with the successful Western Division side in the country championships earned him a New South Wales residence jumper, but it was his modesty and pride on the stage that won the respect of the Country Rugby League.
He epitomised everything that Country Rugby League players are about. It was, you know, like a guy, a first-grade footballer, got up, he got a tear in his eye, and it just brought so much response from the crowd.
For the entire titles, conditions at the Cliff were far from ideal, and it was the same situation for today's finals. But making the most of the solid contestable surf, Newcastle's over 28 and Open champion Brett Chalker did his best. A blistering start saw him score a 9 and 8 from the judges from his opening two waves. It was a catch-me-if-you-can situation, and while Dave Hammond also scored well, Chalker's good start was enough for the over 28 state title. The Open competition was an all-Sydney affair. Mona Vale's Luke Steadman was busy early in the 25-minute final. With most surfers falling short of the 10-wave limit, he was up twice before the opposition had even started. Avalon's Simon Young stood out as the danger, but the Mona Vale surfer hung on to win. The finalists will represent New South Wales at the national titles in Western Australia early next year. After the disappointment of an upset loss to Townsville on Friday and an abrupt end to the season, the Falcons were playing for pride and contracts at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre last night, but not even that could lift Newcastle in the first quarter as Brisbane import Mike Mitchell proved his value with a 12-point opening term. Tom Wisman had the Falcons in an all-too-familiar situation. Tough words from him while the Brisbane camp was a little more supportive. The height of Ben Pepper was enough to keep Newcastle in the hunt, and while the visitors brought the margin back to 6 at the first change, no sooner had they returned than they were on the back foot again. National 9 News. Brisbane reached boiling point when they raced to an even bigger lead. The Falcons were off their game. Uncharacteristic errors saw another turn in possession. Brisbane home by 17 on the siren. The Falcons returning to Newcastle with another humbling defeat. They play their last home game of the season next weekend against Melbourne.
It's the biggest reline for the number 4 furnace since the late 70s. The operation will take 70 days and involve 800 workers. Operations staff are winding down the plant in preparation for the work, while molten iron is being emptied from the furnace so its walls can be relined. Deterioration of the furnace's cooling system in recent months has led to unsafe operation.
The cooling pipes leaking water into the furnace, which causes very unstable operations. And, you know, to have a safe and reliable operation, you really needed to replace those cooling pumps or replace the staves themselves.
Environmental considerations are also part of the operation. When completed, residue slag will be air-cooled in pits rather than water to eliminate the smell of hydrogen sulphide.
We'll no longer be putting water on those pits. We'll be allowing them to air-cool, and that should eliminate the emissions and the hydrogen sulphide odours that the community complains about.
Meanwhile, a mass meeting of steelworkers tomorrow will decide what action to take over BHP's plans for Newcastle. Steelworkers are angry that the company is considered likely to back down on a proposal to convert the works to an electric arc furnace. Australian Workers' Union spokesman Maurie Rudd claims the workforce will vote to strike. Blake Doyle, NBN News.
It's not hard to tell Ron Pine has given up on his Pontiac Firebird. The vehicle that caused him so many headaches last year sits far from pride of place on his property near Cessnock. Hoping to regain some of his old form, Pine is preparing a different car for this year's motordrome season. It's not new, instead the one he raced to the Australian titles in Perth in 1995.
Quite happy with its practice last week. A few minor problems, but we'll get over them. But Saturday night looks to be good.
It can only look better than last year. That fiery clash in the Australian Championships will never be forgotten.
Those sort of results don't go down very well with me. That's why this year will be a different year, and I think you'll find that this Pine will be on top this year.
The upcoming season is expected to be another John and Ron show, an unusual and highly competitive form of brotherly love.
It's good promotional stuff, and I love it. The more John and Ron show there is, the faster I go.
A 600 horsepower engine will be the driving force behind Ron Pine's charge, and while all is shaping up well, another highlight will be a run in sprint cars in November.
Well, they tell me when you get to the top there's only one way. It's hard to stay at the top, but we're going to drive a sprint car, and that's what I really want to do.
Three years ago, he was the leader of one of the state's largest council areas. Today, 60-year-old Doug Carley was in Sydney's Downing Centre local court, convicted of the aggravated indecent assault of a 15-year-old boy. Carley was the teenager's PE teacher and a basketball coach. The court heard that in July last year at his Sydney home, Carley touched the youth's scrotum five times after asking him to undress for a massage. He pleaded not guilty to the charge, but was convicted 2 months ago. Magistrate Julie Hubert today lifted a suppression order which had prevented Doug Carley from being publicly identified. His counsel had claimed that any publicity would not only impede his client's rehabilitation, but might cause him to commit suicide. Prosecutor John Nathan, however, said that as mayor, Doug Carley had craved and enjoyed the limelight, and with such a standing in the community, he should have known better. Carley was placed on a 3-year good behaviour bond. In that time, he must continue psychiatric counselling and must make sure any employer or voluntary group he works for knows of his conviction. It's a long way from his respected position as mayor of Lake Macquarie. He held that job for 18 months before resigning in 1993 in extraordinary circumstances. He was thrown out of the ALP and lost the confidence of the entire council. It followed questions about his spending of the mayoral allowance and a trip to Fiji with a young companion. At the time, Doug Carley claimed he was unfairly under siege. Today's conviction appears to bring to an end Doug Carley's career as both a teacher and a politician. Jodie McKay, NBN News.
It's proof that these students can literally juggle balls and business acumen. They've come up with a simple product and successfully marketed it in the complex business world. The juggling set called Baicha was designed by students from Newcastle University's business and engineering faculties as part of the Young Achievers program. Now on the market, Baicha is being snapped up.
It's been very successful. In particular, it's been a successful learning exercise for the students to come to terms with the teamwork that's necessary in business compared with the individualism of typical university students.
The product contains juggling balls, instructions and a computer disc that shows the user the trick to juggling. An international retail chain has already shown interest, so are executives who use the balls to relieve stress.
Commercially, it's been quite successful, and the shareholders that have invested in this company can expect a significant return on their investment.
It hasn't all been smooth juggling, with the students encountering a range of problems, but they say it's been a valuable learning experience.
It's been great to broaden my skills. In engineering, it's very necessary to have management skills, so it's great to get this area.
Success for these students is in the bag. Blake Doyle, NBN News.
After missing the NBL finals, the Falcons had nothing to lose at the Newcastle Entertainment Centre last night. The home side was playing for pride and contracts, and what better way to do it than to entertain? The Falcons were nothing short of outstanding. Scotty Ninnis showed his skill and his teammates their support before David Van Dyke again made sure of the result. It was the slam dunk show, the Tigers also in the action, but the 209-centimetre giant did everything to steal the limelight. Ben Melmoth joined in, so too Matthew Rees, and that man again. 70-47 at the main change, Newcastle was never going to surrender the lead, the hero again among the points in his personal tally of 38. Out of this year's finals may be, but the Falcons' performance was a hint of what's to come next season. David Van Dyke hailed as the city's new favourite son, while the Falcons enter the off-season on a winning note.
There isn't much left of the carport in the Tingara Heights home, winds topping 80 kilometres an hour, ripping the branch out of the tree.
It sounded like one hell of a big clap of thunder. That is exactly what it sounded like, and the whole house just shook.
Tony Fuller says she has complained repeatedly to council about the potential risk. She's also worried about other trees in the neighbourhood. But Tony is just grateful of one thing, her car wasn't in the carport.
About 2 weeks ago, I sold my car to my next door neighbour. So it's just got out, so I would have had a crushed car underneath it.
It grows well in this environment and it's killing off all the native species, and it's such a strong, vigorous grower that it's making the track inaccessible.
This was the aftermath of the police raid in 1988. Acting on an anonymous tip-off, nine armed officers from the Special Weapons Operations Squad stormed a Mayfield house searching for escapee Raymond Denning. Inside was Zdravka Jovanovski. She sued police, claiming the raid caused her shock and distress and that she now suffers from post-traumatic stress disorder. Judge Margaret Sidis today found the police raid was unlawful and that Mrs. Jovanovski had been disturbed by the incident. She awarded her $95,000 in damages.
The lady's been vindicated and she's been adequately compensated.
While police guidelines describe a forced entry as so potentially dangerous it should be used only as a last resort, Judge Sidis found the officers involved considered no other option. She said the raid placed 50-year-old Zdravka Jovanovski in grave danger.
They neither followed their own guidelines nor did they follow the common law rules about entering into a private person's home. And it's still law that in Australia, a person's home is their castle.
And while at the time the police did repair Mrs. Jovanovski's front door, Judge Sidis said the ultimate affront must surely be that they made absolutely no attempt to repair the damage which they caused to her. Jodie McKay, NBN News.
Lorna Hewson was working as an occupational therapist 20 years ago when she had a stroke. The left side of her body was paralysed and doctors said she wouldn't live.
I felt devastated that this could happen to me without any warning. I had no choice. Suddenly my life had altered.
Since then, Lorna has written two books about her experiences and spoken to stroke support groups. Today she launched a five-part video package called The Stroke Jigsaw as part of National Stroke Awareness Week. It aims to offer practical guidelines about how to deal with life after an attack. While praising health workers, Lorna says there's often a problem with communication between doctors and their patients.
Staff are inclined to talk about the patient and the condition across at the end of the bed. I think the patient needs to be included because they are trying to make sense of what's happened to them.
Lorna is hopeful her experience will help others rebuild their confidence after a stroke.
First Jamie Ainscough and Darren Tracy, now Lee Jackson. The British international is the latest to bear the brunt of Newcastle's financial woes, released with 2 years remaining on his contract.
That was a big shock, you know. My three-year contract, like, and I was hoping to stay here for 3 years. And
it's disappointing from a coach's point of view, but the board of directors have made a decision, and that's the way it's got to go.
To many, though, it may not come as a surprise. Jackson didn't enjoy a good season in 96, replaced at the end by veteran Robbie McCormack. Really says Jackson was 30% below his best this year, but has no doubt dramatic improvement will come next year.
A good off-season on the weights and strength and power training would have ensured that he fulfilled his potential.
You angry at the club?
I think in a way, yes, but obviously, the way things are at the moment, no, that's only option that they are.
The ARL has the task of finding Jackson a new club.
He'll be a very good buy for anybody who he plays for.
And with further budget restraints expected, the release of other knights may be just around the corner.
The long-term financial future of the club is paramount, and everything will be looked at in close detail.
Thank you.
The word is out, Toronto is opening its doors and local business people don't want anyone to miss the boat. A cruiser was chartered today to promote business and investment opportunities, the state government throwing in its support.
It's the launch of the Toronto Prospectus, which is a document that's basically saying to the rest of New South Wales, Toronto is ready to receive your investment.
The main target of the prospectus is the Sydney market, with the freeway making the western side of Lake Macquarie an attractive and cost-effective alternative.
There's no reason to be in Chatswood, Ryde, Parramatta, wherever. You can be just as easily here. It's about 90 minutes to the Sydney GPO, the freeway, the train, and everything's right to be investing on this part of the world.
With a projected population growth of 40,000 people for Lake Macquarie over the next 15 years, the main concern for council is that it's not just commuters that move in, it wants people to live and work in the region.
Each Maitland Council meeting brings a new twist to the Rhonda Bignall saga. A month ago, Dr. John Griffin of Tweed Shire was enlisted to mediate over council. Last night, council proposed to elevate Dr. Griffin to facilitate in decision-making between council employees and general manager Rhonda Bignall.
I would hope that those people who feel open and fair about council do the talking.
But it's those people who are angry that Dr. Griffin won't finish the original mediation process. They say the mediation has been hijacked and is vital to solving council's problems.
We would have preferred for Dr. Griffin to return to Maitland and to complete his process of interview, which was about detecting the level and the depth and the width of issues and concerns within council.
The saga within Maitland Council over the general manager's position has simmered for months now. Mayor John Martin says he doesn't blame ratepayers for being dissatisfied.
Well, the residents of Maitland must think we're unprofessional and immature, and to some extent I don't blame them.
To the full credit of council officers, they're carrying out their role with due responsibility.
Every summer, the coastal village of Pacific Palms is swamped by holidaymakers. And joining the ranks of caravan parks and apartments that accommodate them will be 11 self-catering units in a resort-style development. Great Lakes Council says the project will offer employment opportunities for locals, encouraging other developers to consider the region.
It's a confidence booster to people who are thinking of investing in our shire, in our council area. And this is a very well presented development that takes care of the environment around us.
The proposed development on Boomerang Drive will be spread over 6 hectares, with this dam to be filled and the house demolished to make way for tennis courts and swimming pools.
The site's ideal for it. It's not going to pose any difficulties to the community as it exists at the moment, and it's certainly not going to harm the environment. Indeed, there's some improvements coming out of it.
But nearby caravan park operators aren't happy.
I think the little caravan parks will suffer. They were here first. There's three just in this loop road itself.
Also approved by the council are plans for a tourist information centre for the area.